Welcome to Artbeat. I'm Jeffrey Brown. Woody Guthrie was born 100 years ago this July. He died in 1967 at the age of 55, but he left behind a legacy as one of this nation's greatest songwriters and troubadours. That legacy is being celebrated this year, and here to tell us about him and the celebration is his daughter, Nora Guthrie. Welcome. It's interesting, 100 years later from his birth, who's he connecting with today? What do you see?
Oh, my God. He's all over the place, actually. It's raining Woody Guthrie. it's a fascinating time in American history. Yeah. And we're finding that his songs and his ideas are just trickling into everything, whether it's Occupy Wall Street, little settlements and camps and tents where kids are singing Woody Guthrie songs, or even as an example, 2 weeks ago at South by Southwest when Bruce Springsteen gave his keynote speech. Mm-hmm. So there's just a huge swath of people, whether it's in music or politics or all kinds of rights issues and things like that, including constitutional rights issues, where you find Woody Guthrie.
Which we're discussing every day, but he was talking about them. So for those who don't know a little bit of the history, what shaped him, of course, coming out of Oklahoma and all kinds of events in his life? What do you see as the main points that shaped him?
Well, there's a couple of interesting things that he was actually born into a somewhat middle-class family as a young boy, and immediately a number of tragedies followed. His mother got ill with Huntington's disease when he was young. There was no health care programs there. She was actually put in an insane asylum where he never saw her again after that. They had the Dust Bowl in Texas. They had the Depression. Mm-hmm. They had all kinds of things. I mean, lots of people in that generation had life interrupted. Mm-hmm. It was just one thing after another after another. And I think a lot of that, those circumstances really brought out this empathy in him. Empathy and questioning. Mm-hmm. Like, why is it like this? Why is there no one to help? Why is my mother put in an insane asylum? Why is there no medicine? Why are there no homes? Mm-hmm. Why is there no FEMA? Of course, there was no FEMA at that time when hundreds of thousands of people were migrating. All of was the largest migration in the United States.
He was part
hundreds
of it, right? To California and across the country.
And he was just one of them. It's not like he was leading a band or anything. He was just one of them, and he was listening to what people said. People on the left was, I don't mean left politically, people on his left, excuse me, were saying, you know, why is this happening? Who's for us? Can anyone help? Right. People all around him were asking questions.
He was listening, but he also gave it a music and put it to song. Where did that come from?
Well, that's his contribution. Right. I mean, that's the main contribution is that he put what everyone was saying into rhyme and verse and music. Mm-hmm. And where he got that was from his parents. His mother sang and played piano, and his father sang and played piano. But I have to say, in a way, everyone kind of sang and played something in those days because they didn't have radio, they didn't have CDs and you know, iPods and
so
stuff.
What do you think was the key to his way of his connecting?
The key was listening. And he took music and ballads and tunes from churches, from barbecue socials, from all around him, from other popular writers, the Carter family at the time. Mm-hmm. He always loved music, and what he was able to do, kind of for the first time, was to connect public present-day issues, whether it was the Dust Bowl or whatever was happening, and set it in a musical form. Mm-hmm. And also he did it rather simply because he always believed that people should very easily understand what he was talking about, what he had to say. Not only that, give it a good chorus because they could sing along. And once you sing along with something, it becomes part of you.
What about your own personal memories? You're giving a talk, I guess, at the Library of Congress, and part of that is about the Woody Guthrie you knew. What of his personal character?
To be really honest, it was a really, really tough life with him. He was a great guy. It wasn't because of that, but he got Huntington's disease when I was about a year old. Ah. And he was actually hospitalized for the 15 years following.
Yeah.
So my relationship with him was more like a caretaker as a child,
really?
A visitor at a hospital. He would come home every weekend from the hospital. We would have hootenannies, all of his musical friends mm-hmm. would come. So I would say one of the biggest influences was his friends that were around the house all the time. I mean, I grew up with Pete Seeger playing in the living room, Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee, Lead Belly, all these people were part of the fabric of our living room.
And what was that like?
Loud.
Raucous, but fun.
A lot of tuning going on. Yeah. A lot of tuning, banjo tuning, mandolin tuning. To be honest, I kind of wasn't into it,
you
know, because it was, you know, Dad's.
You turned away, right?
Yeah, exactly. I wanted to
That was your rebellion.
Exactly. Well, I remember with the tuning, and they had these big song circles where everyone would go around and sing a song. My dad couldn't sing at that time, but he would listen, and everyone would sing his songs to him. Pastures of Plenty, This Land is Your Land, Pretty Boy Floyd. Yeah. And then the next generation came in, Bob Dylan and Phil Oakes and people like that, the youngins, who wanted to, you know, touch Woody Guthrie.
Touch the master.
And maybe they could write a song too, you know, it would trickle up and through their veins or something. So that was interesting too, getting to know and hear all of those guys when I was a kid.
So tell us what's happening this year, all kinds of events around the country. You can't walk through all of them, but give us a little flavor.
What we decided to do is from California to the New York Island, this land was made for you and me. Mm-hmm. And how could we express that? If we just did one concert, we could only use this group of people. And if we did this concert, we could only do that group of people. So we thought, why not just take the journey, take the trek throughout the whole country and go to all the different locations where he lived, where he worked. So we started off our centennial in Oklahoma, where he was born. And we did a huge concert in Tulsa, Oklahoma with John Mellencamp and Jackson Browne and Del McCoury and a whole bunch of other, Roseanne Cash came for that. So we just had a big gala concert there because we're actually moving the Woody Guthrie Archives to Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Oh.
So we're building a new facility there. We're working with the Kaiser Family Foundation and creating a whole big facility that has a museum and an exhibit space. And now the archives is going to be grounded, a stake in the ground in Oklahoma.
Great.
Yeah, from there we traveled to Pampa, Texas, which is where Woody experienced all the Dust Bowl circumstances there. So we went to a relatively small town of Pampa, where they have one little storefront that said, Woody Guthrie played music here kind of thing, you know. And I came with my brother Arlo in a big bus, and we pulled up and we did a big concert in Pampa, Texas, you know, to remind people in Texas and Oklahoma that Woody's roots are their roots.
They're part of that history.
There's been a lot of disconnect over the decades. People have kind of forgotten how much we all have in common. So part of this journey is to remind everybody, you know, that Woody was singing about these people and writing about these people. This was his home.
All right. The life and legacy of Woody Guthrie. Nora Guthrie, thanks so much for talking to us.
You're welcome.
And thank you for joining us again on Artbeat. I'm Jeffrey Brown.